Genesis chapter 48 and verse 1. Now it came to pass after these things that Joseph was told, indeed your father is sick, and he took with him his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. Now Jacob lived in the land of Egypt now for 17 years. That's what it tells us in verse 28 of chapter 47, that he lived 17 years. So Joseph and Jacob now have been reunited for this time. And so Joseph is now being told that your father is about to pass away. He's sick. He lived a total of 147 years. That's, I suppose, long enough for any human life. That's a long time to live. But so Joseph decides to take his two sons to go and visit his ailing father. And Jacob was told, look, your son Joseph is coming to you. And Israel, remember that's Jacob, same name, or same person, just a different name. Israel strengthened himself and sat up on the bed. So here he is, this, excuse me, this proud man, and I don't mean that in a negative sense, but he's an honorable man, and he's knows that the ruler over the land is coming, who happens to be his son. And so to be respectable, he decides to gather himself together, to gather up enough strength to be able to sit up on his bed. Well, Jacob said to Joseph, after Joseph gets there, obviously he's going to give him a bit of a history lesson, a testimony, if you will. God Almighty appeared to me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me. Now this Luz or Luz is actually Beth-El, at Beth-El, where he saw the vision of the angels going up and down on that ladder. That's what Jacob is talking about. God appeared to me there in the land of Canaan, and there he blessed me, and he said to me, behold, I will make you fruitful and multiply you, and I will make of you a multitude of people and give this land to your descendants after you, as an everlasting possession. I think Jacob is sort of passing along this information so as to say to Joseph, don't get too comfortable here in Egypt. This is not your home. You're here. And God, of course, is going to use Egypt. He did use Egypt already. But at this particular point, Jacob needs to tell Joseph and, of course, his children about what God had promised them, all of them. Notice he mentions that I'm going to give the land to your descendants. Yes, Jacob lived in the land, but he didn't really possess any of it, or at least not much of it. And so he didn't really have an opportunity to enjoy the promised land like his descendants would. And now let me back up just a moment to verse 4 once again. I will make of you a multitude of people and give this land to your descendants after you. Notice, as an everlasting possession. As an everlasting possession. Now, politically speaking, in our day today, there is a huge, huge debate over whose land Israel is. Now, if you're a Bible-thinking person, you read these things, you read this verse, it's an everlasting possession. That tells us that the land is divinely given to the people of Israel. That's the way we would see that from a biblical perspective. Of course, the world is looking for, I guess, peace is what they're looking for. They want peace, and so their thought is, Israel, give up the land so that there can be peace. And well, that would be terrible because God would not stand for it. That's the way we view that, at least from a biblical perspective. It's not about being pro-Israel at this point. It's just being pro-biblical. That's what the Bible is telling us, that this land is clearly the possession of the people of Israel by divine decree. This was God's perfect will. So I don't care if they were Israelis or Italians. If God gave them the land, God gave them the land. So in obedience to the scripture, that's where we stand. So that's an important little piece of information if you're trying to figure out the biblical process of thinking. God gave them the land. It was an everlasting possession, and that's the way God will keep it. And now, he says, your two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, who were born to you in the land of Egypt, before I came to you in Egypt, they are mine. Just as Reuben and Simeon, they shall be mine. Now, this is a twofold thing here. Jacob is adopting the two sons of Joseph, saying, I'm going to take them. What he's really saying is, I'm going to replace my two older sons with your two sons. So there's this kind of an exchange that's going on. Now, of course, they're not really Jacob's kids, but he's adopting them. They are his grandchildren, and so he is bringing them into the biblical line, if you will. And they actually are going to be numbered with the 12 tribes of Israel. As we're going to see, Joseph does not have a region in the land of Israel. Instead, Manasseh and Ephraim are going to take Joseph's portion. Also, of course, Levi will not get a portion, and that is because they're going to become the priests. God didn't want them to have property. He was going to spread the Levites out throughout the land so that they can minister to the people in a spiritual sense. So that makes up the 12. As you go through the Bible, you're going to see many different types of lists of the 12 tribes of Israel, and there are interchangeable names. The only thing that is similar is that there are always 12 names. So when it refers to the 12 tribes of Israel, we're actually talking about 13 or 14 different people, but the lists are going to change, but it's still the same concept and the same principle, and it all equals the same thing. Well, he's going to take these two sons and replace them. In verse 6, offspring, your offspring, whom you beget after them, you can have them. It says, they will be called by the name of their brothers and their inheritance. But as for me, when I came from Paddan, Rachel died beside me in the land of Canaan on the way when there was but a little distance to go to Ephrath, and I buried her there on the way to Ephrath, that is Bethlehem. So this is the Bethlehem, the one that we know of. In fact, up until recently, this tomb of Rachel was still there, and one could still visit it. You might be able to visit it now. I was told that I read recently that there was some turmoil there in Bethlehem, and they did some damage to this tomb, but I think the tomb is still there. Well, then Israel saw Joseph's sons and said, "Who are these?" And Joseph said to his father, "Well, they are my sons, whom God has given me in this place." And he said, "Please bring them to me, and I will bless them." Now, here is the blessing, the birthright type of a blessing. Well, Jacob was the master manipulator when it came to birthrights and blessings, so this could be a little bit tricky. Now, he says in verse 10, "The eyes of Israel," that's Jacob, "were dim with age," meaning he didn't see that well, "so that he could not see. And then Joseph brought them near to him, and he kissed them and embraced them. And Israel said to Joseph, 'I had not thought to see your face, but in fact, God has also shown me your offspring.'" So here is a very tender moment between father and son. 17 years again have passed, and oh, I can't believe I'm actually holding your grandchildren, or my grandchildren, your sons. I thought I would never see you again, and here I am actually seeing your children. So Joseph brought them from beside his knees, so apparently they were smaller children at this time, and Joseph bowed down with his face to the earth. Here is number two ruler in all of Egypt, and he still respects his elder. He respects his father. He respects the patriarch, not only of the family, but he becomes the patriarch of this nation, now known as Israel. And so he honors his father, and Joseph took them both. Joseph took Ephraim with his right hand toward Israel's left hand, and Manasseh with his left hand toward Israel's right hand, and brought them near. And this was significant because it would have positioned the older child, who was Manasseh, at the right hand, which is the hand of blessing. That's kind of important. Ephraim was the younger child, and so he wasn't expected to be receiving the greater blessing of the elder child, the birthright child. And so that was the plan. Well, then Israel, notice in verse 14, stretched out his right hand and laid it on Ephraim's head, who was the younger, and his left hand on Manasseh's head, guiding his hands knowingly, for Manasseh was the firstborn. So he's got his arms crossed now, holding the kids like this in a tricky way. That was sort of Jacob's thing. He understood these things because he tricked his family as well. But this wasn't a trick. It was actually quite prophetic. And Israel or Jacob makes sure to let him know that. Manasseh was the firstborn. In verse 15, he blessed Joseph and he said, God, before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac walked, the God who has fed me all my life long to this day. Now, in our English versions of the Bible, we read that and it sounds nice. God fed him. The word fed in the Hebrew is the word ra'ah. Ra'ah is the Hebrew word. David used it in Psalm 23 when he said, the Lord is my ra'ah, I shall not want. So it's more than just fed him. God shepherded him, led him through all of the thick and the thin, through all of the mess of his life. Without Jacob even realizing it, most of the time, the Lord was his shepherd and took him where he needed to be, even though he thought it was his own idea a lot of the times, and a lot of his ideas were his ideas, and they got him in trouble. But God got him out of that trouble because Jacob was one of God's chosen for a specific purpose. So he says, God was my shepherd, in essence. And in verse 16, the angel who has redeemed me from evil. Now, in my Bible, that word angel has the capital A and is referring, of course, to a theophany, meaning the appearance of Christ in the Old Testament. And what Jacob is confessing here is that I know this angel was my redeemer. Notice, who has redeemed me from all evil. Well, that is, of course, the role of Jesus. He is the redeemer of us all. Bless the lads. That's his blessing. That's his prayer. And let my name be upon them, and the name of my fathers, Abraham and Isaac, and let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth. So Jacob issues this blessing, a prophetic blessing, on both of the boys equally. In other words, he doesn't raise one above the other. He just simply says this blessing prayer. Now, in verse 17, when Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand on the head of Ephraim, it displeased Joseph. And so he took hold of his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head in order to place it on Manasseh's head. But Joseph said to his father, not so, my father, for this one is the firstborn. Put your right hand on his head. Now, we spoke about this several weeks ago, about this birthright. This was really important to these folks. More so than what we would think. But typically, the birthright not only meant that you were now the head of the family, but it also meant that you would get a double portion of the inheritance. So it was extremely important position. When it came to the people of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and their inheritance or their descendants, It had even more of a priority, which meant the blessing of the Messiah, who would give birth to the Messiah. Well, in this particular case, that wasn't being passed along. The Messiah didn't have anything to do with Ephraim or Manasseh, and so it doesn't apply here. But still, this is going to be an important little thing that's going on between Joseph and Jacob, a little lesson that Joseph is going to learn here. But his father refused, verse 19, and said, I know, my son, I know. He also, meaning Manasseh will also become a people, and he also shall be great. But truly, his younger brother Ephraim shall be greater than Manasseh, and his descendants shall become a multitude of nations. Now, when you look at the ancient maps and you see how these nations actually came together, you see that on the map, Manasseh was a huge region, one of the biggest regions in all of Israel. Ephraim actually was smaller, but over time, Ephraim would be actually equated to the entire northern region of Israel. In other words, he became sort of the head, not he as the person, but he as the people became the head over the northern region. That's a good thing, it's a bad thing, because over time, it was that northern region that would rebel against the ways of God, set up false places of worship in the northern region, and the nation would be divided. That nation then would be called Israel. The southern nation would be called Judah. We'll see that as we get that far. But Ephraim actually is a euphemism for that northern part of the nation. And so he blessed them that day, saying, by you Israel will bless, saying, may God make you as Ephraim and Manasseh. And thus Jacob set Ephraim before Manasseh. Now, this wasn't preference. This was prophecy. Jacob is speaking, whether he knows it or not, I think he knew it because he says, I know, I know. He was actually prophesying over these two boys, meaning this is what God wants. It's not my will here, Joseph, Jacob would say. This is the will of God. So I know what I'm saying and I know what I'm doing here. In fact, in Jeremiah, we're going to come to that once again, Jeremiah chapter 31, God actually says, I am a father to Israel. Ephraim is my firstborn. So he takes Ephraim and uses him as a kind of a marker for the northern kingdom. Well, then Israel said to Joseph, behold, I am dying, but God will be with you and bring you back to the land of your fathers. Again, this is a divine prophecy, but it was a prophecy that would take some 400 years to be fulfilled. So everyone involved in this died off before ever seeing that prophecy happen. But that doesn't mean it's the end of the prophecy. God is eternal. He goes on and on and on and on. And when he says something's going to happen amongst nations, it's going to happen. It will absolutely happen just as God said it was going to happen, or as God plans for it to happen. And so God is speaking to Jacob. Jacob is telling his son Joseph, you're going back to Egypt or to Israel at some point. Moreover, I have given to you one portion above your brothers, that would be Ephraim and Manasseh, meaning Joseph, you don't need, Joseph didn't need a portion at all. He was quite wealthy by this time. And nor would Joseph ever see the land as he promises here. I've given you one portion above your brothers, which I took from the hand of the Amorite with my sword and my bow. Joseph wasn't going to benefit from that, but his descendants would. And that's the point. And Jacob called his sons and said, gather together that I may tell you what shall befall you in the last days. Now, these last days are not the last days we typically think of when we think of New Testament last days, but this is your future, is what he's saying. And what Jacob is doing under the anointing of God, and like I said, whether he realizes it's anointing or not, or if he's just speaking, but God is definitely speaking through him. This is the future history foretold. This is what's going to happen to you as nations and as people. Gather together and hear, you sons of Jacob, and listen to Israel, your father. Reuben, you are my firstborn, my might, and the beginning of my strength. You are the excellence of dignity and the excellency of power. Well, that is until you ruined it all and were disqualified from your firstborn status, from your birthright. Notice verse 4, you are unstable as water. No one can stand on you. No one can trust you. And therefore, you shall not excel. You can only go so far. And the reason? Because you went up to your father's bed when then you defiled it, and he went up to my couch. And so we know this from Genesis chapter 35. Reuben went into his father's bedroom and slept with his concubine, Bilhah. Jacob didn't do anything at that time until now. It's funny that sin has a way of finding us many, many years later, especially if we let it go undealt with or unrepented. We want to be able to repent of our sin because we don't want any lingering consequences. Simeon and Levi are brothers, instruments of cruelty or violence are in their dwelling place. Let not my soul enter their council. Let not my honor be united to their assembly. For in their anger, they slew a man. They slew a man for raping their sister Dinah. You remember that in chapter 34 of Genesis. And in their self-will, they hamstrung or crippled an innocent ox. Now, when you cripple an ox, the idea is you want your ox as useful as possible. You have an ox for the sake of doing work. That's why you would own an ox. But when you hamstring it, you limit it. It's only able to do so much. So you hold it back. Now, he may be talking about himself. Remember, Jacob didn't like it when his sons went out and killed all of the people for raping their sister. And so Jacob's concern at the time was pathetic, as he said, "You've made my name stink in all of the land." Well, he was concerned about himself. You've hamstrung me, is what he might be saying here. But he says, "Cursed be their anger, for it is fierce, and their wrath, for it is cruel. I will divide them in Jacob and scatter them in Israel." So anger here is mentioned, and self-will. Those are a bad combination. Those things do not work the righteousness of God at all. Anger needs to be brought under control. Self-will needs to be died to, because that is the flesh. Judah, you are he whom your brothers shall praise. Remember, the name Judah means praised. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's children shall bow down before you. Now, it's talking about Judah being like a ruler, a king, a reign, being able to reign for a long time. It goes on and talks a little bit more. I'll mention that again. But verse 9, it says, Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He bows down. He lies down as a lion. As a lion, who shall rouse him? So you remember the phrase, the lion of the tribe of Judah. from Revelation chapter 5, verse 5. It's talking about the one who was worthy to open the scroll. The lion of the tribe of Judah, he is worthy to open the scroll and to take back the reign, if you will. This is sort of what it's talking about. This is the lion of Judah. This is who this is. This is the first mention of it, the introduction of the lion that comes from Judah. And so in verse 10, he says this wonderful prophecy. The scepter, meaning the authority to rule, the scepter is that thing you hold in your hand, it means whoever owns it is the king, kind of a thing. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, never, nor a lawgiver from between his feet. Now, this is an interesting prophecy because it didn't even begin, probably, I'm going to say probably, until the first king, David. I say David rather than Saul because if you remember, Saul was not God's choice, but the people's choice. David was God's choice, and all of the promises are really attached to David. Saul is sort of a forgotten thing when it comes to the prophetic picture. It all starts with David. The Messiah was going to be the son of David. It all had to do with the beginning of his reign is this beginning of the scepter. And so the promise is when that starts, the scepter shall not depart. You'll have your own authority the whole time. Well, that authority was often threatened. It was diminished. But it really wasn't until about, this probably didn't happen. David came about 640 years later or so. So this prophecy was given here through Jacob, but wasn't fulfilled until, didn't even begin until 640 years later, and 1600 years until Jesus. And Jesus is, of course, the fulfillment of the scepter that will reign forever. It's interesting that around 7 A.D., Herod was the king at the time, and Herod made it illegal for the Jews to carry out capital punishment, to kill people or put people to death. It is believed that that's about the time when Jesus was born. By taking away your ability of self-rule and self-law, if you will, it was the end of their sovereignty. The Jews were walking around kind of mopey-faced at that time, saying, oh, the scepter has departed, the scepter has departed, not knowing that the scepter was born. He just hasn't matured yet, hasn't grown up yet. So it was all part of the prophecy of God, that the lawgiver will always be between his feet, so to speak. Notice it says, until Shiloh comes and to him shall be the obedience of the people. Shiloh is a word that literally means rightful king, the rightful ruler, but it is a term that refers specifically to the Messiah. So it could easily read that the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Messiah comes, and to him, to the Messiah, shall be the obedience of the people. You see how that actually makes a little bit more sense. So this is a messianic verse referring to the coming one, the coming Messiah. Interesting that Jacob knew about it. I wonder how much he knew. I wonder what he could see. But he predicts the coming of this Messiah even before the nation of Israel was born. So in a legitimate sense. Binding his donkey to the vine and his donkey's colt to the choice vine. It's interesting that the region of Judah was known for its vast vineyards and good wine through the centuries. He washed his garments in wine and his clothes in the blood of grapes. Revelation talks about when Jesus comes in victory, how he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Of course, again, all prophecies, not of this Jacob's son Judah, but of the descendants that would come after him, in particular, the Messiah. His eyes are darker than wine, his feet whiter than milk. And each, now the sons, verse 13, speaks of Zebulun, who settles there in North Israel. Issachar settles in North Israel, northern Israel. Notice it says Issachar is a strong donkey lying down between two burdens. He saw that rest was good. It's possible he's saying he was strong but lazy. He didn't like to get anything done. He just laid around. The burden was on him and he just kind of fell underneath it. He didn't want to do anything about it. Dan settled in the central part of Israel near the Mediterranean Sea. Gad in verse 19 is a troop shall tramp upon him. A troop shall tramp upon him, but he shall triumph at last. And interesting thing about Gad and Reuben and half of the tribe of Manasseh. As they were coming into the promised land, they opted not to enter the promised land. They were on the east side of the Jordan, and they say, hey, this place is great. Let's just stay here. And so they didn't enter in, but Moses said, that's fine. But you go in, you're going to have to go in and do battle. You have to go in and fight first. Then you can come back and settle your farms and settle your families. And that's exactly what they did. Today, that region is called Jordan. It's on the east side of the Jordan River. That is today the nation of Jordan. Bread from Asher shall be rich. Naphtali is a deer let loose, as he uses beautiful words. And now we come to Joseph. Joseph is a fruitful bough by a well. His branches run over the wall. So Joseph's talking about his son and how wonderful it is that he's able to provide for so many other people because he just keeps being blessed and blessed and blessed. Even though, verse 23, the archers have bitterly grieved him, shot at him, and hated him, but his bow remained in strength, and the arms of his hands were made strong by the hands of the mighty God of Jacob. From there is the shepherd, the stone of Israel. So here is another reference to his God. By the God of your father who will help you, and the Almighty who will bless you with blessings of heaven above, blessings of the deep that lies beneath, blessings of the breasts and of the womb. The blessings of your father have excelled the blessings of my ancestors. Up to the utmost bound of everlasting hills, they shall be on the head of Joseph and on the crown of the head of him who was separate from his brothers. So he's basically giving the story of blessing. He's not giving him any future because Joseph's future is really, his job is done. Joseph's job is complete. He had to suffer for all of those years in order to preserve the nation. That's what he did. That's what he was called to do. He did it well. But in essence, there was no future. The future of Joseph's posterity was now in his two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, who will play out his role now, if there is a role for Joseph. It would play out his place through his two sons in the nation of Israel, the history of the nation of Israel. And you know, it's interesting, you hear all of these names. They were all, as we'll see in Exodus, they're all assigned different regions of Israel. And as we travel through Israel, even the people, the tour guides, the bus drivers, they all talk about regions by the name of these people. They use the names of these people. Oh, they're up there in Manasseh. Oh, they're over there in Dan. Or they're up there in Zebulun. They have these regions all marked out by these names that they still go by today. In verse 28, all these are the 12 tribes of Israel. And this is what their father spoke to them. And he blessed them. He blessed each one according to his own blessing, meaning according to what the Lord was showing him, he can only give them what God was showing him. Then he charged them and said to them, I am to be gathered to my people, so bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephron the Hittite. In the cave that is in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre in the land of Canaan, which Abraham bought with the field of Ephron the Hittite, as a possession for a burial place. So you remember, Abraham bought this cave and he put all of his loved ones in there. And all of them were buried there, Abraham and his wife, Isaac and his wife. And now Jacob put his wife Leah in there, and he's saying, I want you to bury me there as well. In verse 31, there they buried Abraham and Sarah, his wife. There they buried Isaac and Rebekah, his wife, and there I buried Leah. So it's interesting how he could have had himself be buried with Rachel over in Bethlehem, but that was the one that he loved. But for some reason, Leah, the one that was overlooked, was the one that was blessed so much. God must have spoken to him or something, put me with Leah. And I kind of like the ending of that whole thing. And the field and the cave that is there were purchased from the sons of Heth. And when Jacob had finished commanding his sons, he drew his feet up into the bed and breathed his last and was gathered to his people. And that means not only were his bones placed in the cave with the other relatives' bones, but I'm sure this had more of an eternal thought. I'm going to my ancestors. And that's the way we see heaven. When we die, we're going somewhere to be reunited with loved ones. And that's what heaven is to us. Then Joseph fell on his father's face and wept over him and kissed him. And Joseph commanded his servants, the physicians, to embalm his father. So the physicians embalmed Israel. This is not something that the Jews did. They quickly put their deceased loved ones in a grave, usually within 24 hours. Embalming is a process, doesn't happen immediately. And so this was the Egyptian way. So the physicians embalmed Israel. 40 days were required for him, for such are the days required for those who are embalmed. And the Egyptians mourned for him 70 days. Now, this was no doubt something that wasn't done because the Egyptians required it, but Joseph, being familiar with the Egyptian ways, realized that embalming caused a body to last longer. And I imagine traveling through the desert with a horse with traveling through the desert with a dead person in the back of the trailer, you know, of the wagon, it would get a little rank after just a day or two. And so embalming would have helped that process quite a bit. And they were very grateful for that, I'm sure. Because the Jewish tradition, they would have buried him right away. But Jacob said, no, take my bones and bury me with my wife over there in the land of Canaan. Well, 40 days were required for him, for such are the days required for those who are embalmed, and the Egyptians mourned for him 70 days. Notice, such are the days required for those who are embalmed. Not all Egyptians were embalmed. Only those who had money could be embalmed. And so Joseph, of course, made sure that this happened, and that's how Jacob was honored. And obviously, it wasn't just his family that was honoring Jacob, but the whole country of Egypt honored him. When the days of his mourning were past, Joseph spoke to the household of Pharaoh, saying, if now I have found favor in your eyes, please speak in the hearing of Pharaoh, saying, my father made me swear, saying, behold, I am dying in my grave, which I dug for myself in the land of Canaan. There you shall bury me. Now, therefore, please let me go up and bury my father, and I will come back. And Pharaoh said, go up and bury your father as he made you swear. So Joseph went up to bury his father, and with him went up all the servants of Pharaoh, the elders of his house, and all the elders of the land of Egypt. Wow. As well as all of the house of Joseph, his brothers, and his father's house. Only their little ones, their flocks, and their herds, they left in the land of Goshen. And so this huge entourage of the sons of Jacob and all of their elder sons and wives, and of course, now all of these leaders of Israel in great procession to honor the death of this man, Jacob. So with great honor, he died. This guy that was chased around the countryside by his brother and then by Uncle Laban, and now here he is in this place of honor. There went up with him both chariots and horsemen, and it was a very great gathering. And they came to the threshing floor of Atad, which is beyond the Jordan, and they mourned there with a great and very solemn lamentation. He observed 7 days of mourning for his father. And once again, this is with the Egyptians present. And when the inhabitants of the land, the Canaanites, saw the mourning at the threshing floor of Atad, they said, "This is a deep mourning of the Egyptians." Therefore, its name was called Abel Mizraim, or the mourning of Egypt. This is where they mourned. And they got it confused. It's an interesting name because it doesn't say the mourning of the sons of Jacob. It became the mourning of the Egyptians. As there are so many Egyptians there, they thought that someone big and famous had died in Egypt. They did. They just probably weren't sure who it was. And so his sons did for him just as he commanded them. For his sons carried him to the land of Canaan and buried him in the cave, the field of Machpelah before Mamre, which Abraham bought with the field from Ephron the Hittite as property for a burial place. And after he had buried his father, Joseph returned to Egypt, he and his brothers and all who went up with him to bury his fathers. Now, that's the end of the story of Jacob. But obviously, it's got some repercussions, as we'll see. Joseph's brothers saw that when Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they thought this is his time for revenge. They said, "You remember when Jacob and Esau were having trouble, and Esau swore, 'When my father is dead, I'm going to kill Jacob.'" That was what he swore at that time. Well, maybe they're thinking this is sort of what's happening. "Perhaps Joseph will hate us and may actually repay us for all the evil which we did to him." Now, that was pretty gross of them, actually, to think that way. Remember now, 17 years had passed. They're thinking Jacob must be carrying this grudge for 17 years, plus the 20 before that. So 37 years of hatred and revenge and plotting and planning to do to pay them back. But you see, that's what they would have done. That's what the brothers would have done, and that's why it was in their heart to think that Joseph was going to do that. You know, there's that New Testament scripture in Titus that to the pure all things are pure, but to those who are defiled, nothing is pure. And Joseph was a pure-hearted man. Even through all of his pain and bitter experiences, he didn't become bitter. He instead became merciful and kind and gracious. And apparently these rotten brothers are still rotten because they're thinking, "Joseph's going to kill us. That's what we would do. Oh, Joseph's going to get his revenge. That's what we would do." But Joseph is not you. Joseph isn't anything like that. Apparently they were afraid of that nonetheless. And so they took a page from their father's book. So they sent messengers to Joseph saying, "Before your father died, he commanded, saying, 'Thus you shall say to Joseph, I beg you, please forgive the trespass of your brothers and their sin, for they did evil to you. Now please forgive the trespass of the servants of the God of your father.' And Joseph wept when they spoke to him." He wept, no doubt, because I think he just felt so bad that they would think this poorly of him. Joseph obviously didn't have that in his heart. He may have had a thought or two in his head years ago, years earlier, but I'm sure that was gone from him by this point. He just wanted to get on with his life, with his brothers, and catch up of all the lost time that they'd lost together. And he wept when they came and spoke to him in this way. So his brothers also went and fell down before his face, and they said, "Behold, we are your servants." This is what their father Jacob did to Esau. You remember, it was sort of a pathetic begging, and that's what was going on here. And Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid, for am I in the place of God?" You know, it's interesting that in the position that Joseph was in, many people would have called him Lord, referred to him as Lord, because he was a ruler. He was over that whole land. But though the people may have called him Lord, Joseph didn't let that go to his head. He understood that this was by God's grace that he was permitted to go up to this position and with this much authority, and it never went to his head. You know, they say that absolute authority will corrupt, or I forget the saying right now, but there's a corruption that actually happens or can happen when someone has great authority or great wealth. It does something to them. And it's not something that just anyone can have possession of. To have possession of such great power can really do things to you. Make you believe that you're really something. Make you believe that you have some sort of authority or greatness in you. And that didn't happen to Joseph. And I'm happy to say that it didn't. But I'd like to say that we all, especially if you are in a position of authority, you need to know that God is the one who raises up and God is the one who puts us down. And so keep that in mind, in regardless of where you are or who you are in any place of authority. Am I in the place of God? This is rhetorical. Of course not. I'm not God, is what he's saying. But as for you, I'm not stupid either, is what he's saying. I'm not God, but I'm not stupid either. I know what you did was you intended evil against me. I know that was your plot. That was your plan. But God meant it for good. I've seen that God turned it all around. He foiled your plan in order to work his own plan. And so I'm not bitter. I'm not holding anything against you. All I can do is marvel at the great thing that God has done, even though your plan was an evil plan to hurt me. I see the hand of God who turned it all around. And notice what he says here. God meant it for good in order to bring it about as it is this day to save many people alive. I want you to see the humility of Joseph here. He didn't say, "What you did against me was evil, but God brought forth my righteousness," or "God turned it around so that I look good," or "I came out of it okay." No, God did this for a reason. He saved many people from this. It wasn't about Joseph. Do you see that? He didn't defend himself. He didn't even mind being used by God in that way, as painful as it was to have to live through it. When he saw the result of it, it's almost as if he would have fallen on his face before God, as if to say, "Thank you for letting me be a part of this amazing plan. What an amazing plan. Who would have thought that you could have done such a thing, O Lord?" He saved many people. Surely, as you think about it, that the people of Jacob's family would have starved to death like so many other people did in that region. But God had a plan. The plan involved this family, but it's bigger than this family. It's about the Messiah. And so God's divine plan was set, it was set afloat, so to speak, not adrift, because it was perfectly on course, exactly as it had to be. And so he's trying to reassure his brothers in verse 21, "Now therefore, do not be afraid. I'm going to provide for you and for your little ones." And so he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. Boy, I tell you, this is so good. This is so rich with the Christian message, if you can see it. If you know, Jesus said, if someone strikes you on your right cheek, turn to him your left cheek as well, your other cheek as well. Don't return evil for evil. This is the Christian way. It, of course, is hard because in our flesh, we want to respond. We want to return evil for evil all the time. You took out my eye, I'm going to take out your eye and your left foot, kind of a thing. I'm going to give you more than what you gave me. The law was meant for fairness, so an eye for an eye. That was the Old Testament law. You take out someone's eye, then you have to lose an eye or give the value of the eye. That's the idea. But the law prevented them from going further. Joseph wasn't under law. He was under God. He saw himself under God. And in that sense, he was able to give kindly, comfort them, provide. All of these words are not the things that a bitter person does. So he's not bitter, is my point. He's blessed. He's blessed. He knows it was God who did this. What a lesson in faith to be able to see God as bigger than our situation, bigger than our problems, bigger than the people who seem so big, who seem so big in our lives. They're brutal or they're all powerful. They're not. God is. So throw yourself in his hands and don't leave yourself exposed to what you think people might do. So Joseph dwelt in Egypt, he and his father's household, and Joseph lived 110 years. So his father was 147. He lived 110 years. I guess all of that stress of running that country was a little much. Joseph saw Ephraim's children to the third generation, so his great-grandchildren, the children of Machir, the son of Manasseh, were also brought up on Joseph's knees. So he saw all of his grandchildren, great-grandchildren. Joseph said to his brethren, "I am dying, but God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land to the land of which he swore to our ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob." And so Joseph is now reiterating the promise. Don't forget the promise. Don't forget the promise. Remember God's promise. And he passes along the covenant of promise. It's the best thing we can give to our kids, by the way, is the promises of God, the life of God, the life of Christ, the promises of the Word. Keep passing them on. Keep passing them on. And then Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, "God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here." So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. Very different. In a coffin. They would have just buried him in the ground or covered him with a pile of rocks. But in this case, they put him in a coffin, and many people believe it would have been a coffin inside of a pyramid. Think about that. Pyramids existed then, but that was only for royalty. And there was recent discoveries made, in recent, probably the last 100 years or so, where there are those giant pyramids that we see, but all over the country are also smaller pyramids. And it's possible that the body of Joseph was put in a coffin and put inside one of those pyramid structures until, as we get into Exodus, we'll see, once they leave the nation of Egypt, they gather up Joseph's bones and take them with them 400 years later into the promised land. So this is the beginning. That's what Genesis is, the book of beginnings. And this is where it all kind of is set in place. Now we start following this line of the Messiah, the law and all this and how it comes into play. And of course, then we start learning that Jesus is the fulfillment of the law to bring salvation. He is Shiloh. He is the Messiah. He is the Redeemer of mankind. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you that we had this opportunity to go through this wonderful book of beginnings. I pray that we would take the lessons and the many, 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 many hundreds, countless more lessons that will come to us in the following chapters of the Old Testament. And teach us, Lord, not Old Testament law, but the Christian faith through everything that we learn here. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.